And now the end is near, so I face final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear, I'll state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full, I traveled each and every highway and more, much more than this. I did it my way. Regrets, I've had a few, but then again, too few to mention. I did what I had to do and saw it through without exemption. I planned each charted course, each careful step along the byway and more, much more than this. I did it my way. That I bit off more than I could chew, but through it all, and there was doubt, I ate it up and spit it out. I faced it all, and I stood tall, and did it my. Laughed and cried, I've had my fill, my share of losing, and now as tears subside, I find it all so amusing to think I did all that. And may I say, not in a shy way, oh no, not me, I did it my way, oh what if.
Welcome to St. Mary's for this service for John, bringing your love for him, preparing to give thanks for John. This is our service, our chance to bring our thoughts, feelings and memories before God as we commend John into God's tender care. We come as his family into God's tender care. We calm his family and friends to support Andrea and each other. My name is the Reverend Canon Glyn Evans, and I'm honoured to be asked to conduct this truly wonderful man's service. A wonderful man. He has been taken too early from us. And unfortunately, due to the current restrictions, everybody who want to attend cannot. If they could have all come, we could have all gone and filled St. James's Park, I'm sure, on this day, with the people that knew him and loved him and would cheer him on. I knew you, John, while I was vicar at Long Horsley. Remember once him asking me if he could have a picture of me, a signed picture, because I was coming famous, and he wanted to put it up in the shop. And I go in the shop and there it was behind the counter. I was talking to Andrew this week and we were going through things each other, and I was going through things, some cards my children had given me. And into my drawer I went, and then what did I find? The signed picture that John had given me over 20 years ago. A sign from God that he was still smiling at us all and smiling at me. I've met many characters, but not one quite like John. And while in Long Horsley, John first got ill, and he used to joke with me, "If I'm to die, I want you to take my funeral clean." I'm sorry to say, I'm having to this day. We often chatted, and I'm sure many of you waited in a queue for many hours to get there and see him and talk to him. But the wait was always worth it. Like a vicar, really, you talk to him. You confess things that have gone on in the time. You could share your joys and your happinesses and your sorrows you'd share with him. You were always welcome when you met John to talk to him like an old friend that you hadn't seen him for years. And you'd always leave him, once you'd met him, the better person for having known him and spoken to him. That's why we meet today, to remember his life and to commend him to God. So a moment of quiet, as perhaps you can picture him in your head, how you loved him, and a special moment you come to give thanks for on this day. So a moment of quiet in your head to think of him and think, oh, that's how I remember him. Will you please be seated? From our service booklet. We remember that we meet in the name of Jesus Christ, who himself died and was raised to the glory of God the Father. Amen. We have come here today to remember before God our loved one, John. We have come full of our own thoughts and our own memories. We calm ourselves in this place to reflect and listen amidst the emotions of the day. John's earthly journey is over, so we gather to give thanks for his life, to celebrate who he was, all that he achieved, and all that he meant to us, and all that he gave. We're here to recollect his life and honour his memories. We're here to commend God, John's body, John to God's keeping, and later to commit his body to be cremated, to comfort one another in our grief. We make this prayer in Jesus, our Saviour's name. Amen. Andrew and the family have chosen this well-known psalm for us to read together. It's a picture that was given by David, who was a great king, but he was a shepherd, and he'd go out into the fields and he'd see what was going on. As John went up to Rothbury or wherever he went on his journeys and his trips, he'd look out and he'd see the fields, the lambs. They always used to say at a funeral of a butcher, they should have that anthem, "Sheep may safely graze." But of course he did that, and he went out to the country and he'd enjoy it, talking to people, helping out wherever he was. David the king was a shepherd, and at the time he gave a picture of what he think heaven might be like for him. And he pitched it, a place where there would be green pastures, there'd be a stream, a place where he could sit and watch the world go by. So as we read it together, perhaps you can think of times you've shared with John, or when you've met him out in the fields, or where he's gone out to Rothbury, or wherever he went, to those places that David remembers a picture of heaven might be like. So we say together, the Lord is my shepherd, therefore can I lack nothing. He will make me lie down in green pastures and lead me beside still waters. He will refresh my soul and guide me in right pathways for his name's sake. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff comfort me. You spread a table before me in the face of those that trouble me. You have anointed my head with oil, and my cup will be full. Surely your goodness and loving kindness will follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. James, the man, is going to read our reading, which speaks of Jesus speaking to his disciples before he was to die. And of course, he was scared, and they were scared of what death would bring. He was speaking to them and saying, try not to be afraid or troubled. He said, God prepares for each one of us, and John, a place in heaven, because God knows all our needs. And he was reassuring there's a room, a place for John in heaven. And perhaps as James reads it, we can remember the home that he shared with you. A home that's been a place for you, a blessing. Or he's visited your home. And how that home has shared love and kindness. A home that God prepares for you now. So James.
A reading from John chapter 14.
Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, so that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I'm going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way? Jesus answered, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. So do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid.
If it wasn't for our families and our friends, life wouldn't be worth living. John depended on you all so much, Andrea I know, but also the family that brought him joy and happiness. So firstly Vanessa, and then Catherine is going to read us a poem or say some words that they've chosen for today. So Vanessa.
I'll cherish them forever. I miss your laughter so much and the mischief in your smile. When I feel the sadness well enough, I'll remember it a while. For though you are no longer here, you'll never be truly gone. So long as I have these memories, your spirit will carry on. Until I see your smile again, I hold you in my heart and mind. A shining example, my Uncle John, one of the best of humankind. Tired, a cure was not to be, so he put his arms around you and whispered, come to me. With tear-filled eyes we watched you as you slowly slipped away, and though we loved you dearly, we couldn't make you stay. Your golden heart stopped beating, your tired hands put to rest. God broke our hearts to prove to us he only takes the best.
So proud of you, and it's just well done. Does it just be smiling from here to here? It would be, just loves it. So a few words that Andrew has written about his life, and just of course it doesn't sum up his whole life. We've all known him so many different ways. And of course his life started, it always made me smile when Andrew said, he's Alexander John Munro. Of course John Alexander Munro would be Jan. Of course he always used to make him smile, so it was John as we knew him. He was born at Rothbury Cottage Hospital when it was there. And my wife was born there as well. She came from Throckton. I would know that area really well. His birth was on the 14th of June, 1962. So we remember all that life he shared there. Remember his parents, Sheila and Gordon Munro. And then, as many of you know, he grew up at 17 Church Street, living as a baby with his mum, dad, nana and granddad. His granddad would give him the love of gardening, which many of you talked about. And Andrew, he had a laugh about caterpillars and cabbages that happened. Of course, he had two wonderful siblings, Michael and Diane, people he shared his life with as a child growing up. We share memories and their families and loves throughout his life. As we all know, he went to work at Greens in those days when he was 15 years old. Some of the children moan about starting to work, but 15. And worked there all his life. And as we know, he loved the customers, and they sure did love him. He met his future wife at the bottom of the garden. Of all places to meet your future wife. She moved there to the bungalow in Rothbury Road, which backs on, as you know, to Church Street. Romance blossomed, as they'd say. And they would go on to get married on September the 12th, 1987. John did not move far, straight down the garden. John and Andrew were married for 33 years. But Andrew knew things to come. Little things happened at the wedding. They had to stop on Alnwick Moor to hear the football results on the way to the reception. And so she knew what was setting her life ahead. John loved his extended family. And of course, May and Herbie, of course, sadly lost recently. As John called them, the little mammy and pa, all part of the family, so much part of his life. His brother-in-law Barry and his wife Jackie, and his sister's family, and brother-in-law Robert, and of course the kids we've heard from, Vanessa, Catherine, James. Of course the support they're getting at the moment from Catherine's fiancé Chris, Vanessa's boyfriend Ross. As he grew up, of course, in this place, he wanted to be fully involved in its life. His heart and soul was here. In the time, John became a parish councillor. At that stage, you had to stand for election. And everybody was so proud that he got the most votes in the village, which of course to many of you was no surprise. He served faithfully on the parish council most of his married life. He was a trustee on the Memorial Hall Committee. It sounds something like out of the Vicar of Dibley. Having been on there since he left school, he knew all the goings on there. He was a leading force there in getting a new hall built and worked tirelessly looking after that hall. He joined, as you have to in the North East, I've learned, the League Club at the Village Inn. And he even managed to win a cup one year, which I'm sure he told you about often. He loved his garden. It was always a riot of colour there. He would spend hours in the garden, more talking though to everyone who passed by, which was probably more time consuming than the actual gardening that he actually did. As I knew and you knew, John was a season ticket holder at Newcastle for many years. Didn't matter if they won or lost, John would still not be content. They always needed a new manager, according to John. And he was devastated when Mike actually bought the club and moaned about it to anyone that would listen, and we had to. As I said, sadly, he became ill 23 years ago, in 1997, when I knew him. He developed a virus, which led him to becoming very ill. Ill with his dilated cardiomyopathy, which in old terms was an enlarged heart. A man with a big heart, as we know, ironically, had that happen to him. I remember talking to him and we never found out, he never quite ever understood what had happened to him. But of course he'd recover that time, and Andrew and him would have 22 happy years together. But sadly the illness came back to him, as you know. Really, he should have a heart transplant if he could have done, but that was not to be. As many of you know, he was taken from us on that Boxing Day, tragically at the age of 58, with all that life ahead of him still. But we're here to remember the life he has led. The life when on Sunday mornings, John would do his paperboy act, delivering papers to the family. Probably more for the chat, as that should have taken a few minutes. Of course, John and Andrew have spent their lives together and loved your holidays, even getting adventurous and driving abroad and all around the UK, sharing lives together. But Andrew, you and John have been a team. Without you, he couldn't have been that man he was. A solid team. Foundations made on solid rock. We give thanks for your married life. We give thanks for the love that you've shared with each other. Any of us who knew John and Andrea knew that behind all the bluff and that sometimes, he was like a vulnerable child. You cared for him, you looked after him. His love and care that you shared have been fantastic. There were many words we spoke about when I came to see you, which all give a bit of a picture of him. Never say no, was John. Timekeeping suspect. Cards, hundreds and thousands. The cat, boiled ham every breakfast. Storyteller, inspirational, helper and friend. The Bowls Club, Newcastle United. He's got to go. He knew what cut of meat you always wanted. He knew before you even asked. Prince Charles ate his sausages. Andrea, voice of reason, best friend. A loving man with a big heart. We support the British Heart Foundation with their gifts. Finally, he'd say, always look on the bright side of life. For us, he's a local hero. Many people loved him. And Mason has chosen a piece of music, I think, that we're going to listen. Sorry? Ryan. Is going to, Ryan, a little piece of music called Heaven, I think, which speaks about that heaven, that picture of heaven. Thank you.
Present. Can't believe you're in heaven now, knowing you are. heartache we're facing now. When the sun shines, we know we're looking down. I see your smile, I hear your voice. The times we shake, can't believe you're gone. I miss the past, I miss the past. I'm gonna miss the love we had. Now you're an angel, wish I could have saved you.
God of mercy, Lord of life, you have made us in your image to reflect your truth and your light. We give you thanks for John. We reflect on all that was good in his life, for all that he meant to us, for the difference that he made to so many lives, and for the memories that we treasure today. And so we thank you for the gift of John. And we ask that you would meet us in our sadness. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, you're full of grace and favour. You're tender towards your children. And so we ask that you would heal any memories we have of hurt or failure. And you would bring us into the fullness of your kingdom, where sins have been forgiven and death is no more. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, even though you conquered the grave, death is still an enemy that robs creation of your intent for life. So help us to work for all that brings life in this world, for everything that enables blossoming, flourishing, healing, so that we can know life and life to the full. And give us the wisdom and grace to use aright the time that's left us here on earth to turn to Christ and follow in his steps in the way that leads to everlasting life. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father God, your mighty power brings joy out of grief, life out of death. And so we pray for each one touched by John's death. And this day, in particular, we commit to you Andrea, Michael, Diane and Robert, May, Barry and Jackie, James, Vanessa and Ross, Catherine and Chris. And we ask that you would reach out and encircle them in your loving arms, that you'd give them courage in their loss and their sorrow, that you would be their refuge and their strength, and you'd lift them from the depths of grief into the peace and light of your presence. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And finally, Father, we pray for the communities of Long Horsley and Long Framlington this day. And we pray that you would comfort us in our loss. And you would help us to honour you and John by working for the good of our communities. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We finish our prayers with the Lord's Prayer. If you'd like to join me, please do so as we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Will you please stand? We now come to commend God in this place to God's care and into God's keeping. Into your hands, God of mercies, we commend John, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessing which you bestowed upon John in his life. They are signs to us of your goodness and our fellowship with Christ. Merciful, will turn towards us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant. Help us to remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with John forever, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Into your hands, O Lord, we commit ourselves, our work and the tasks that await us, our homes and the members of our family, our loved ones, and especially those in special need. We entrust ourselves and those that we love into your hands. Help us, guide us and keep us in your care for all that lies ahead of us this day and forevermore. Amen. So may the love of God and the peace of the Lord Jesus Christ console you and gently wipe away every tear from your eyes. God give you comfort and peace, light whose joy in this world and the next. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen. So we go from this place, the same tune, I think, Unchained Melody.